it's academic and it's theater, the place where they both meet.
You have the audience and participant for each other.
Intellectual practices, historical practices, cultural practices.
Everyone? Everybody, please.
Examples of women.
Sharing what it is that you do, sharing how you do that.
There's no way you can ignore Latinos anymore.
Work from all around the world you can come and see and talk about.
Theater for everybody, yes, everybody.
That's just what should be done.
And indeed, my understanding of life, relationships, death has already changed.
The survival of theater as an art form depends on that.
But there's room for it all. There's room for it all.
Well, thank you for indulging with us. Of course, it's just for Thomas, so he knows better what we are doing. But since you were here, we'll do that too. So first of all, welcome everybody to the Martin Siegel Theater Center here at the Graduate Center CUNY on a 2 p.m. On a Thursday, which is an unusual time, but it's the time that works. So really, thank you for taking the time out to join us here. And of course, welcome to Marvin, but most of all to Thomas Ostermeier for taking the time out of his few days in New York that potentially would give him a chance to see art or go to the park or do some shopping in the drama bookstore, of course. And so really, thank you for joining us. And his play just opened last night, Richard III, and it was, I think, it's a very, very impressive production, fantastic acting and a brilliant dramaturgy, and I think also the space worked beautifully. So thanks for BAM for bringing him over, and also thank you for the Schaubühne, as we learned, for the great interest. It's one of the few companies in Germany that actually, you know, really tries to establish international ties, stay friends, and work to make this happen, and that means a lot to all of us here in the city. So it shouldn't be longer than an hour 15 minutes. Our discussion, we also have some questions with it. We have a short reception afterwards here. If you have a cell phone, and maybe just double check, and I'll do the same if it's off. Looks like it, mine is. So thank you very much. So we'll start off and say, Thomas, opening last night, how was the reaction? How does the audience look at the play? What did you think?
It was nice. It was nice. Well, I thought it fits very well. I think it's perfectly for the Harvey Theater. We especially built in Schaubühne a new space for this production, where we oriented ourselves on the architecture of the globe. And as you have in the hallway this half circle, it's pretty similar to the space we perform in Berlin. And I'm happy that there's such a lot of interest, a lot of people wanting to see the show. We could add some performances, maybe. It was nice.
At least for us, or for our eyes, it also felt right away a comment to contemporary America and, you know, our political leaders. Was that intentionally, or is that something we...
Of course, I changed the play just last night. Completely rewrote when I understood we're going to New York. What I liked is that you don't need any moment of... there were so many productions before of Richard III where people put up swastika as a flag and or other fascist symbols or aesthetics, which is for me not interesting at all. It's a very simple thing to say, oh yeah, Richard III, he's like a fascist leader. It's very much simplifying, and it's a wrong idea of what we call in German, or what we would call Regietheater, you know, like having a banal conception of a very complex play. And if anybody believes that this character is linked to fascist past or fascist present time, that should be something which the spectator has as a thought while watching. It's very patronizing to have a director telling the audience what is his opinion. I'm always fighting to during rehearsals with my actors. I'm always trying to tell them not to have an opinion, not to have an opinion of about the character, not to have an opinion about what's happening in the play, because it's, to me, it's very boring to watch a show and then a character comes up and I see from the very first moment, oh, this actor believes that his character is stupid or intelligent or beautiful or evil. It's not interesting. I think as an actor, you should be prepared to live under the given circumstances of the situation you're put in by the director and by the play. And when you have an opinion, you're not in the situation, you know. So it's very anti-Brechtian, because Brecht kind of was thinking about this distanced relationship to the character, and to show, actually maybe not anti-Brechtian, but it's anti-cliché of Brecht theater. You know, it's where people do believe that, yeah, it's to show a political attitude, while I would say the non-cliché Brecht is to tell the action or the story in a rational, inspired by your brain way of telling it, and not so much being emotionally involved. Anyway, I don't know if this is interesting. I don't know what are we talking about.
Very, very much interesting. I mean, it was, I think, Heiner Müller who said using Brecht without criticizing him is actually treason. And so I think that surely you
yeah,
are
he, yes, I think this quote he must have stolen, Heiner Müller, because the original quote, is which I love a lot, is by Meyerhold, who said a good student of a master is a student who betrays the master.
That's a good thing. You're coming to students. I welcome also Marvin here, is a professor here at the Graduate Center, one of the most significant and great theater historians on this planet Earth. And his special interest, of course, has been European theater, German theater, especially over decades. The European theater journal is out for over 30 years, I think. How do you fit, where do you see Thomas's work fit in the European context and also American?
Well, am I on here?
Yes.
I guess so. I think, I'm certain that I first encountered Thomas's work 20 years ago. I was in Berlin, and my colleague, I was talking to my colleague Manfred Pfister there, and I said, so what, above all, should I see in Berlin while I'm here? And he said, there is this brilliant young director who's really now caught fire with everybody at the Barracke Theater, and his name is Thomas Ostermeier, and he's introducing the new British in-your-face theater, and so Manfred and I went to see Shopping and Fucking, which was indeed a stunning production. And that was must have been 20, I guess about 20 years ago. And I have followed Thomas's work with great pleasure ever since, as he's expanded out from that particular school of drama, and which he really established in Germany, and then on into productions of Ibsen and Shakespeare, two of my favorite dramatists, I think almost everybody's favorite dramatists. We've been fortunate enough in New York to see a number of these productions. One of the things I most deplore about the New York theater is that we don't get to see a lot of European work, and we've been fortunate that we've seen a number of Thomas's works here. So I think many of the audience have had a chance to see a variety of these plays. I was fascinated to see the restructuring of a section of the Schaubühne into a kind of globe-like space, which I thought was brilliantly done and beautifully used for this production. For those of you who don't know the Berlin Theater, the Schaubühne is one of the great theaters of Berlin. In some ways, I think today, the greatest theater in Berlin, certainly one of the two or three outstanding theaters. And it was first, yes.
Since we are talking about it, we have an approved clip from the Schaubühne about it, a short one.
Oh, well, let me just say a word, and then let's sort of, just to say that this was a building converted into a modern theater for Peter Stein, and so Thomas now is sort of the second great international director that has headed that theater, and has thus continued on a tradition of making that one of the central theaters of Europe and of Germany and of Europe. So, yeah, let's see this clip about it.
Internationale Festivals uns einladen, weil sie sich einen Teil von Berlin einladen wollen. Weil diesen Mythos, den Berlin heutzutage besitzt, diesen Nimbus, den es weltweit besitzt, den laden sie sich mit diesen Aufführungen mit ein. Thank you.
Also heute fand ich das, hat es mir ganz gut gefallen, oder ich habe mich sehr gut darüber gefreut, dass die Leute miteinander auf einmal dann auch geredet haben. Und dass wir dann irgendwie auch ein bisschen unwichtig wurden. Das ist super. Wenn man diese Diskussion aufmacht, dann ist sie so, wie sie ist, und das ist dann völlig egal, so wie sie läuft, sozusagen. Manchmal freut man sich dann auch daran, dass die Leute so teilnehmen, und manchmal ist es auch eine Erkenntnis, wenn nicht.
Wir bitten mal jeden, der ihrer Meinung ist, einfach die Hand zu heben.
In der Form der Reaktion gibt es Unterschiede, aber das Gefühl, dass überall auf der Welt, wo man hinkommt im Moment, die Leute zweifeln an der Veränderbarkeit von Wirklichkeit durch Politik und zweifeln an der Möglichkeit, dass die einzelnen Gesellschaften überleben können, in dieser politischen Form überleben können. Das ist sowas, was alle Orte bisher geeint hat.
So, Thomas, so why do you do theater, and what's your vision for the Schaubühne?
Well, it changes always, and I think this is the most important thing. You know, there's this beautiful and famous quote of Trotsky saying, or talking of permanent revolution, and I think that's also true, especially nowadays. For me, it's absolutely true that you have to change each and every moment to adapt or to resist what's happening in the world. Watching this, because there were some moments of audience participation, which you saw, that was in Istanbul, and we are now discussing very intensely if we can go to Istanbul, because there's a lot of Germans in prison, German journalists, for very weak reasons or for no reasons at all. And we are really afraid, because when we brought the enemy of the people to Istanbul, what you saw, people were talking about the fact that they're living under fascism, that the media is controlled, that there's no freedom of speech anymore. That was some 4 years ago. And even then, there were newspapers in Istanbul attacking us, because they said it's a German power game that we are talking about, Erdogan government. I just did a movie in Russia as an actor, which created a big provocation. And there were, I don't know if you heard about this here in the States. It's a movie about the last Tsar, which is holy now. And there's Russian Orthodox church members, extremists, who do believe that you cannot portray the Tsar naked and in a love scene. And there were two attacks on the production office. There were two cars burning. There was an attack on the lawyer of the producer. And there was a truck with gas loaded running into a cinema. And there's my friend Kirill Serebrennikov in under house arrest, Russian theater director and filmmaker, for no reason, political reasons. They put him into under house arrest, and they threaten him with 10 years of prison. And we at the Schaubühne had a production which you also saw here, Fear, where we were called to court for three times because members of the extreme right party in Germany brought us to court because they didn't want us to show their photos and to tell their names in the show. Luckily, we got two times the judge decided for us for the freedom of the arts, but there's or three times, but they are going into revision, and so there will be another trial in a few months. So only to give you an idea of under which circumstances we are, and not talking about bringing Richard to New York and what it means, on which different level it resonates here in the States. So making theater now is completely different to making theater 2 or 3 years ago, because the times changed tremendously. And so the last productions I did, I was only focusing on these changes. And also the production I'm preparing now will be about the rise of populism, the rise of xenophobic, racist, homophobic leaders and thoughts, and about this change of climate everywhere in the world. So the reason for why I do theater at the moment is obvious. I want to talk, or I have to talk about this. But the deeper answer to this question would be, there's this beautiful first line in Hamlet, which says, "Who's there?" That's my major concern, in the sense of who's there when a human being says, it's me. What is this me? Who am I? What is the human being? And how, it's also a question about how do I myself find a way through life? Why am I here? And what could be a deeper sense of being here? And how do you lead a life which makes sense? Well, that this is and. Fortunately, I have this privilege to research on these questions in the rehearsal room with the actors, and that's what I'm doing. And I'm lucky enough to have a lot of audience members who share this interest, or who still come to see my shows, because honestly, I'm not so much, when I'm rehearsing, I'm not thinking about the audience. I'm really doing what I need to do. So I do believe it's incredibly lucky that there's so many people wanting to see this obsessions. And that's nice. Talking of this, and my last production, which I did premiere at the Manchester International Festival in summer, that was a true experiment. Nina Haas, who's member of the company in Schaubühne, and some people might know her because she's a character in Homeland, the television series. She was, during the campaign and the election of Trump in New York because she was shooting Homeland here. And so we've been in contact a lot, and she was very much concerned and shocked about the result. And we have the same issues in Europe and the same problem. And so we thought we should do something about this. And that's why we decided to do this book, which is a philosophical, sociological, autobiographical essay from this writer, Didier Eribon, where he describes his childhood as a homosexual in the province of France, coming from a working class background, very poor background, and a family which always was communist family and communist voters. And when his father died, which he hasn't seen for 20 years, he had to go back to Reims. And he found out that all of a sudden his whole family was voting for Front National, which is the extreme right. And so he had to think about why is this? And he finds a very interesting analysis of this, which is that it's partly because of the left. It's a failure of the left. The left, which lost contact to the disprivileged, underprivileged working class. And so these people don't feel represented anymore by the left. So they had to find a new group of people which they believe represent them. And for me, this made a lot of sense. But it was a clear, what we call in German Sachbuch, I don't know how to translate Sachbuch in
nonfiction.
Nonfiction writing. And to do this on stage, I felt the urge to do it, but it's not dramatical. It's not something which you usually would make theater out of. And surprisingly, it worked. Had an incredible success in Manchester, but also now we did the German version, and we're bringing it to New York, to St. Anne's Warehouse in February. So again, another proof for me that it's more important to know why you do something and what you have to talk about and what you want to research on and what you want to tell. Or what you want to find out, that's the most important thing for me. There's not such thing as a form or a certain line which you should follow. I mean, I did a lot, as you said in your introduction, I did start with contemporary British playwrights, but then I had a time of 10, 15 years where I did a lot of Ibsen, Shakespeare productions, also contemporary productions, but now most of the people consider me as a director of classical plays. But now I have to change again because I have to talk about new things.
We have a very short clip of a 1 minute clip of from the Manchester Festival. Maybe just have a look at it.
Had I followed the same path as my brothers, would I be like them? That is, would I have voted for the National Front? Would I wax indignant about the foreigners who are invading our land and acting as if they belong here? Would I share with them the same kind of reactions to what they consider to be the aggressive actions they suffer from at the hands of society, the state, the elite, the powerful, or others more generally? To which us would I belong? To which them would I be opposed? In short, what would be my politics?
Yeah, maybe I'm just going to explain what you just saw. So what we did in the conception of this work was, how do you tell this non-dramatic, non-fiction, deeply philosophical text? So what we decided to do was that we did a movie. We shoot a movie, a documentary with Eribon. So we reenacted this journey to Reims. We met his mother. We went to the cruising areas of Reims. We went to the suburbs where he grew up. We went with him to Paris and so on. And the stage, the set is a studio where you do the dubbing of movies. And so you see Nina, and she tells the text on the images. Where Eribon is actually the main character of the movie. And so, and then she gets into a fight with the director on how to talk about social misery, how to make a political engaged film dash theater without being patronizing, how to talk about being part of the middle class elite, talking about disprivileged people or underprivileged people. All these issues came up between them. So it was about what I just described, the development of politics in the Western world, but not only Western world, but then also about the question of how does artists deal with this? How can you find a position in that?
I'm quite struck by what Thomas says about various ways in which he is quite fortunate, and he is, that is, as being as his position as a an important theater artist in Germany with the actors that he has and the situation that he has. But equally important, he mentioned how fortunate he was in his audience, and I think that that really does need to be underlined, that it's very difficult for me to imagine a major United States director that would undertake this kind of project, that could undertake or would even think of undertaking this kind of project. Not that there is not a very great commitment to political and social concerns, but just that the American theater culture does not really consider that to be part of what theater does, nor do audiences expect it or work for it, or encourage it. I would like to believe that the audiences are there, but we don't really know because nobody is trying to find out. Of course, this is a situation that really goes back, it seems to me, very far in the cultural histories of the countries. That is, for a long time, Germany has considered theater to be an important stage of public social debate. That's not been true of the major American theater. By and large, the major theater in the United States is considered to be either a kind of museum theater of the classics or an entertainment theater. But very rarely do we present plays that, well, never do we present a play like what you're just talking about, just never. And even our politically, no, I mean, really, I can't, can anybody imagine a major American director in a major American theater or a major New York theater doing a production like this? It's just inconceivable.
But
But we will come to audience questions soon. We also next to social and political, you know, context of the theater, we also do talk about the craft and the work. So we would also like to know your way of working in the production. How do you approach it? How many weeks do you rehearse? How do you work with the actors? How do you treat, especially with the class, also the text? It's so unique what you do, but so someone's kind of how do you make it question? So could you give us a bit of a context of your approach to create work, your own one?
Well, what we do, and again, after the praise of German theater, I have to tell Marvin that also in the theatrical landscape in Berlin, there's a lot of change. And I'd say there's major threat to this idea of theater, which I'm representing, which is the theater of repertoire and ensemble, which is something not existing in American landscape, not existing in British theater, not in France and other European countries, which is the idea of a group of people permanently employed and building up a repertoire of plays which change every night, or every second night there's another show in the theater. And this is how the German system of theater, institutionalized theater, mostly works. And this is part of, to answer your question, which shapes, or what shapes my choices and my craft and the way my work develops. A lot of the actors I'm working with, I do work together for 18 years, 15 years, some 20 years. So the actor playing King Edward in Richard III, he was already in Shopping and Fucking, which you saw, and since we're working together, Lars Eidinger, who's doing Richard, joins the company since 1999. And so I'm not only a director, but I'm also kind of the in the best way, I would be the spirit, or the keeper of the spirit of this company. Also in the sense of raising artists, raising talents. The company was always a company of very young actors. And this is very different to a lot of other companies in Germany. So what we did when we started in 1999, we said, okay, now we challenge ourselves in installing a young group of actors, not famous, not well known, and build up an ensemble, and build up the careers of actors. Now, I just learned yesterday, one of my actors told me that now we have the reputation in Berlin to be the theater of the stars. But all the actors, all our so-called stars, like Lars, like Mark Waschke, Jörg Hartmann, even Nina Hoss, she worked with me at the school. We were both trained at the same theater school. So they all became famous, but they were part of the Schaubühne mostly for all the years. So this is really my project, which is very different to the life of a director who casts for a show. Then that's what I'm trying, is to build the art of being an ensemble. What we call in German, or nobody calls it anymore, nobody's talking about it anymore, but what has a beautiful name of ensemble Kunst. And I'm really defending this idea, and I do believe that this success of German theater, the worldwide success or inspiration it gives to a lot of other theater makers, is linked to the fact that we still have this luxury and privilege of working together as a group over the years and the years and the years. And I do believe that a lot of theater makers I admire and who created an era did this with their actors. Like Peter Stein was dependent on the art of the members of his company. Also true for Frank Castorf, for example. So these, when you think about these theater makers, or let's talk about Ariane Mouchkine, if you want to talk about a French theater maker. When you think of these theatrical events, you immediately have faces in front of you. So this theater is built out of personalities of actors. And what is so important for in the life of an actor is to lose fear, to lose fear of going on stage and to be connected to your creative sources. And fear is, of course, the enemy of creativity. So what I'm trying to do in my theater is to get rid of fear. And that's especially important today in Germany. I mean, Germany is anyway a genius in having fear. I think we are the most afraid people in the world. But even more, amongst the younger generation, it's increasing and increasing. You know, they lose trust in the future. I'm also teaching directing, and I can tell that it really changed. The students are more and more afraid of building up a career or even a private life. No, it's seems for them more and more difficult. So what I'm trying to do is to create an atmosphere and a space, at least in the rehearsal room, where they're not thinking about these fears. Because a fearless space can give you incredible new input and can make your talent grow. And that's what happened over the years with the ensemble of the Schaubühne. And I'm also happy to what happened to us, because it's proof that when you have trust for a longer amount of time, things can really develop. So it's in our modern times, where success has always to be fast and immediate, and immediate profit and efficiency and all that, we tend to not have the time anymore and not give the time anymore to young artists and talents to develop. But the company of Schaubühne and maybe even myself is a true example of that it's worth waiting and giving time. And if you give this time, you, all of a sudden, people are talking about of Schaubühne as the theater of the stars, which were they were not there before, you know, and they were made in the theater. All of them, or a lot of them, also have a career in television and movies now, some of them even internationally. But it is because they lost their fear over the years of being on stage. You know, like an actor like Lars had 25 performances every month over the last 15 years. So, you know, he doesn't have time anymore to think about being afraid. You know, he's more on stage than off stage. And so it's like a fish in the water when he's on stage. And this is my project. Of course, then, because I mentioned the art of an ensemble, what I'm also trying to work on is a theater which is not theatrical in the negative sense of the word, meaning we have had, especially in German theater, we have had periods of expressionist, formalistic, great, beautiful theater, but it became a meaningless form. So a lot of theater I see in other theaters is people imitating the masters of yesterday in the form, but not in soul. So so what I'm trying to do is to go back to zero, to reset, and to try to arrange a true meeting of two people, and I'm saying human beings here, or people and not actors. I want these people to meet on stage, and this is again something which has to do with trust and losing fear, because a lot of theater I see, the actors would not even realize if you take away their partner off stage while they perform. And there was a time, I mean, a lot of what I'm talking here about, of course, for those professionals amongst us, it rings a bell and they thought, oh, yeah, it's Stanislavski. Yeah, of course, I'm influenced a lot of by Stanislavski and his thoughts. But what is very interesting for me is also that in a certain way, he overcame the theater of stars. He was fighting against the theater of stars, you know, against this old manieristic way of being up front stage and talking to the audience, even so I have a dialogue with a partner, like opera. And I do believe that it was a beautiful and humanistic act of saying, okay, your partner is not only the audience, turn around, there's somebody else sharing the moment with you. And I do believe that again and again in the history of theater, this repeats. But this is also what happened in the 60s, in the late 60s, in German theater, when we still had this old school declamatory theater of the 40s or the 30s. And then with this generation of Regietheater, Peter Zadek, Peter Stein, Peimann and also, they again said, okay, turn, you share this stage with other audience members. And now, and then after this development, again came up a new generation of theater makers who do believe being in a formalistic frame and not looking at the partner with you on stage is avant-garde and it's new. But it's not. It was the convention of 1880 in Russia. You know, it was a convention of opera-like theater. I'm completely fine with this. What I don't like is, first of all, pretending to be avant-garde. And second, I don't like when it's only a form, when this form has no meaning anymore. And as maybe because, and then I'm going to finish to talk. What I'm also trying to achieve in a rehearsal room is that I myself make an experience with the actors, and that has maybe to do with the fact that the last 20 years, most of the time, I was in a rehearsal room. And if you repeat over and over again your form, you don't have any experiences anymore. It gets very boring in a rehearsal room. So what I'm trying to do is set up a frame, a situation for the actors where they can make experiences which then can lead to something which is new, which is a true meeting, and which also the actors cannot know before what is going to happen, but the reaction in the performance is a result of what's happening in front of me with my partner. So it's really going into territories where you haven't been before, because what I'm trying to do is to re-establish or find again the immediate response when you play, for example, like children, and they don't think about, oh, how do I look from the outside to the audience when I react to my partner? So, and that's what I'm really trying to find again, that it's a truthful play which is not censored by your brain, but which is really happening. And then when it happened, you can discuss, is it worth to be in the performance or not? But it should be while developing it or improvising or working on a scene, there shouldn't be any censorship.
Well, thank you so much, and I think this is a truly, an invaluable insight. And again, thank you for sharing your time with us. And it's we are all really honored to have such a great master of theater here with us. Before we go to audience question, I think we might talk about your idea of that kind of capitalist realism. I mean, Marvin and I talked about this, and you also wrote about this. Here, maybe to give a little idea of that. It's such an interesting, it's important. If you want to.
No. I definitely want to. You know why? Because I think there's a lot of misunderstanding.
Let's get it right.
And it's very difficult to explain, because actually, if I say capitalist realism, it's an ironical remark. And others do believe that my way of theater they could label with capitalist realism, which is not true. If they want a label for my theater, I would call it hyper-realism or sociological realism, but not capitalist realism. When I'm talking about capitalist realism, it's an ironic remark referring to socialist realism. Socialist realism was the ruling aesthetics during Stalinist time. So
You grew up in East Germany.
No, I didn't.
You went to East. You went to the Schauspiel.
I learned theater in East Berlin. Yeah, that's right. But I'm a communist from the West, which exists. So socialist realism was the ruling aesthetics of Stalinism, and it was not allowed to perform or to portray the world in a different way. So it was an affirmative way of portraying the world, which meant there's a socialist hero, we are going to a golden future, we are developing the den Menschen der Zukunft, the human being of the future. That was the idea of socialist realism. But it was an aesthetic, an affirmative aesthetic of the political system. So when I'm talking about capitalist realism, I'm talking about post-dramatic theater, which, or performative theater, a certain type, where I, as an ironical and provocative statement, would say this is affirmative to the capitalist system, because it says, very verkürzt, very shortened, it says the world is too complex and too much broken into pieces, and there is no historical subject anymore, so we cannot portray the world and we cannot tell who is responsible for what's going on. And this I find very dangerous. So an avant-garde movement of deconstructive aesthetics, which had its reason in the 70s, late 60s, became an affirmative aesthetics which does not put into question the system we live in. It just agrees that our reality is so multi-layered that we cannot see through anymore. So we completely abandon the idea of portraying the world, and by portraying it, understanding better to change it. So the idea of change is completely gone. It's not there anymore. And that's why I'm using this term of capitalist realism as a denunciation of a certain aesthetic, making a reference to socialist realism. Is that clear now?
Yeah. Marvin?
That's right, yeah.
Another question or remark?
No, I think that is clear. It really is if I may be permitted, it's a kind of a Hegelian move. That is, you've had socialist realism, capitalism realism, and now you're building upon those to deconstruct capitalist realism, which is a very German move, I might say.
Yeah, that's. I just wanted to mention this. You don't know what I'm talking about if you're not in this cultural landscape of making references to this and to that. And socialist realism, I mean, I was even trained in this art form, you know. So in my group, when I say capitalist realism, everybody knows that it's referring to socialist realism, while here it sounds like, I don't know, like an advertisement.
Or something good, right?
Yeah. Right. Something good, even, yeah.
Well, let's open up, and maybe, Brad, let's put some light up for the audience. We start with Jim. Who has the mic? We are recording it, so that's why we will have... my friend, do we have an extra mic? Yeah. Is it on?
Yeah.
And could you give it to Jim? Thank you again, Thomas. Really, thank you.
Oh, I have a question that I've been wanting to ask you for quite some time, which is, I've seen a number of your productions multiple times, and I'm taken by how invariably even when they're in and out of a repertory, maybe there's extended periods of time they're not performed, that when I come back and see it again, it's grown and it's become more specific. I mean, I saw The Richard 2 years ago and saw it last night, and I just, you know, was very taken by that. It's the same show, but
where did you see it 2 years ago? Where did you see it?
I saw it in Berlin. Are there things that you specifically do to ensure that a show is not going to go dead when it's not performed for a long period of time?
Yeah, definitely. to the discomfort of my actors, I'm rehearsing again and again. So, for example, yesterday afternoon, I think the team of BAM was a bit irritated by the fact that there was a technical run announced to put the show in a very short period of time, and all of a sudden I was rehearsing one tiny little scene for 2 hours.
Which one?
And not, I won't tell you. no, it's not a tiny little scene. It's actually the most difficult and beautiful scene in the play, which is, of course, Lady Anne and Richard. So I was rehearsing this for 2 hours. So in the end, we didn't have time enough to do all the technical installation and the light and also to the discomfort of my technicians. They are, if they are accusing me of one thing, it is you're only concerned about your actors. You're never concerned about the light. You're never concerned about technical issues. Never concerned about when he's in the end flying up. We have to rehearse this. It's dangerous. So I'm really passionate about actors and about again and again and again work with them, and it's never finished. And it's not only never finished because they can do better, but it's also never finished because I understand more when I see the show again. All of a sudden, I didn't get that. Oh, especially with Shakespeare. It's so beautiful when you work on Shakespeare and you have the chance to see it again and again. It's adding a new layer, and that's why I have to rehearse again and put everything into question. Even so, it looks from the outside, it looks the same. But I'm not working a lot on the outside. I'm working always on the motives of the character, on the situation, on the emotional expression, on really meeting each other on stage. So, yes, that's what I'm trying to do. I'm fighting against routine.
Yeah. Routine.
I'm fighting against the fact that an actor goes on stage and says, oh, I did it well yesterday, and I know how to do it, and I do it the same way again. And that means that for some years I'm working with Sanford-Meisner technique, repetition exercise, which became crucial to my work. And I learned this by Mike Bernardine, a guy is teaching this in London, British guy. And this is really very important to my theater, because I'm trying to tell my actors that what's happening in this moment on stage is because what is happening in front of you in the eye or in the appearance or in the emotion of your partner in front. And your partner is different every night, so your performance has to be different every night. And if you perform different, your partner in front will see you and also perform different. So please meet on stage every night in a truthful way, and don't repeat something prefabricated which you thought you understood during the rehearsal process. Meet for real under the given circumstances of the play. That's as easy as that.
Thank you. Is there another question coming up?
Thank you very much for a fantastic, elaborate explanation of the reason behind the truly magnificent ensemble work that you do. I would like to make just a brief comment. To me, this is truly what theater is about. It is the live human being confronting, meeting with another live human being, and by extension, that extends also then to the audience, and that is the power of theater. And that distinguishes it from film or television in a powerful way. I have a question. The physical demands from the actors at the Schaubühne are really amazing.
I don't think so. They could do better. And well, more.
But I remember, I mean...
Say the question.
You haven't seen my shows when I started my career. That was demanding.
Well, maybe Michael Ebert did. Thank you very much.
No, but what was the question about the physical demand?
The physical demands, the extreme demands of physical action on stage, such as the hanging upside down of Richard.
He loves it.
Such as the in the lower depths or the Nachtasyl, the entrances and exits from the stage, the physical demands are stunning, yeah. Which are an extension, of course, how the emotional investment and the physical demand. So what kind of training? That's training. My question. Mm-hmm. What kind of training do you demand from the actors beyond the training that they may have had in acting school?
Well, as I said, some of the actors, and this is true maybe for 2/3 of the actors in the company, they have a lot of performances every night. And I'm always telling them, well, you can be lucky because you don't have to go to the gym. You know, you perform. And part of their training is the performance. This is really true for Lars, for example, you know. After having done Richard, he doesn't need to work out anymore, you know. So this is one thing. Another thing is it sounded funny when I said it could be more, but I really do believe that we could be physically even more or better. Sometimes I ask them to do for example, I ask them, if you have seen Richard III last night, in the beginning I ask them to jump from the first gallery on the floor, and they never succeeded. So when I was trained in theater school in East Berlin, my most important teacher was Gennady Bogdanov, who was a student of an actor of Meyerhold. So he was trained by an actor who learned biomechanics by Meyerhold himself. And as you might know, theater history, Meyerhold was forbidden for years. He was killed as a Trotskyist agent in Stalinist times, and it was not allowed to talk about Meyerhold till Perestroika and Gorbachev arrived. So these actors met secretly every Saturday in Theater an der Taganka in Moscow, and this teacher taught them in biomechanics, secretly. And when the wall came down, Bogdanov came to Berlin and became my most important teacher and influence. Even so, you don't see it anymore in my work. The theater of Meyerhold, as you know, is much more physical. It's like circus, acrobatics. It's and even the shows we did, that's why I was kidding that you haven't seen my first shows, like when I did Man is Man at the Barracke with Bogdanov, because we did two shows as a duo, a directing team. The actors were flying. That's my dream of actors, you know. That and Bogdanov always said in the rehearsal room, if the director asks you as an actor to go up the wall, you don't have to ask him why or how, you have to try and you have to succeed. And it's your task to find out how you can fly as an actor. So in my dreams, I'm dreaming of a completely different theater than I'm doing. Completely different.
Another question.
What are you doing in terms of the next generation of the theater that you're building, or the theater that you dream of?
Well, first of all, as I mentioned, Schaubühne, this Schaubühne, was always the theater where young actors can have a career. All my productions are on the shoulders of actors who were not stars before they came and joined Schaubühne. So it's really a place where young actors can develop and spread. And I love young actors. I really love, especially when they haven't been to another theater before, you know? Because when they spend some time at a theater in, I don't know, Wiesbaden or Münster, and they're fucked up, you know? They are cynical. They are working in a sense of, it's a director. He doesn't know what he's talking about. You know, they are really very, very cynical in their attitude towards theater. And I like actors even more before they came to theater school. You know, it's always like, sometimes you can see people entering theater school and they have a certain shine in their eyes. And after 4 years, this shine is gone. You know? This is it. If you take acting serious, and if you take it serious that the art form of an actor is himself, herself, her body, and her soul. And this is the material they're working with. of course, this is a very fragile art. It's very fragile, and that's why I really like to work with young people, because I can make them flourish. So this is what I'm doing for the next generation of actors, on the level of directors. We have a program for, I don't know, 6-7 years now, where we invite students, theater students, directors, actors from all over Europe, and for 3 years now that also NYU Tisch School of the Arts is joining this 10 days program, where they have master classes, where they can see shows in the evening, meet the directors, and what is even more important, that they meet other theater students. Last year we had people from Turkey, from France, Italy, Sweden, Germany, and New York. And when students from New York told the other students how much they pay for their university per semester, they were shocked, of course, you know? They were shocked, and they understood the reality of
capitalist realism.
Of capitalist realism, yes. But also it is, and that's also a big problem in European theater and European drama schools, that it's completely staying in bourgeois class, and there's no working class in drama schools and in theater. And that's a big problem for theater, because how would they do? You were talking about that there's no engaged American theater, but there was Arthur Miller, so I would ask myself how would they do an Arthur Miller play if they don't know the reality of being first-generation immigrants, you know? And first-generation immigrants or children of first-generation immigrants nowadays would not be able, only if they were an exception to the rule, to attend a drama school in the States. That's a problem.
Over here, the middle.
You spoke a moment ago about the danger of actors meeting on stage but just repeating themselves rather than engaging honestly and spontaneously. Of course, that's a danger between the play and the audience as well, I think, especially when you're doing something like Shakespeare or Ibsen, when an audience often believes they know what the play is about before they show up. I know you've mentioned a couple of times that you don't think much about the audience, but you know, an enemy of the people, you have obviously the actors speaking directly to the audience and challenging the audience. So in enemy of the people, it's fairly clear how you do that, but I was wondering, in your other work, if you think about how you think about creating that honest, spontaneous, I see you right now feeling between production and audience.
Well, the audience always sees the actors honestly, you know? I don't have to develop the skill of the audience, because they see it for the first time, and I don't have to ask them, well, pretend you meet this situation for the first time in your life. While this is one of the major demands I have to my actors, I'm always asking, no, go back, this is not how it would look like if you were in this situation for the first time in your life. So everything what's happening with the audience is truthful. all the emotions of the audience are truthful. I mean, if they are bored, this is truthful. This is what they are, you know. So, of course, what I'm trying to do with my actors is to ask them to really see the audience. And you can observe this if you go to see it. And sometimes when you have monologues, people, actors standing up front and pretending to talk to you. And then if you look close, there is a little how is it, some shimmer? A shine in front of their eyes. If you look close, they're not really watching you. So this is what I'm trying to ask my actors to really, and I don't know if you realized it, even yesterday night, every single noise happening in the audience, I'm asking my actors to respond to. Everything what's happening is part of the performance. Somebody leaving, part of the performance. Somebody coming back from the toilet, it's part of the performance. There's a noise, they are waiting to go on. They're not ignoring the presence of the people in the space.
Maybe one more question, yeah.
I have two questions. I guess they are
just one because we have.
They are interconnected. I guess I want to know that how do you understand the notion of the director's self in this very specific kind of repertoire arts and very specific director-centered structure, and in relationship with the era of this 2017, full of autonomic expression and also the shattering of the social realism, or kind of like one man dominant structure. Yeah, these are two questions, I guess.
There were times where at the Schaubühne, the ensemble did collective productions, which means they met and put up shows without a director. But that was the initiative of the actors. So I would welcome any initiative of actors coming and telling me, we want to do this text, we want to talk about this, we want to do this project. There's a very famous example in the history of Schaubühne, that the first show of Peter Handke, Der Ritt über den Bodensee, Peter Stein didn't want the play, Dieter Sturm didn't want the play, they hated it, and they didn't find a director, and Klaus Peimann agreed to do it with a group of actors, Bruno Ganz and Jutta Lampe, and because they wanted to do it. So we, yeah, only to tell you, I think I do understand what you were heading to, and my answer would be, I try to be open to any impulse from the outside of audience members wanting to do autonomous work.
Good. So I think we our time is up. We also have a little reception. Maybe as a closing a question or statement. You know, how do you see as an America? How do you receive all these impulses that are flying over? And what are your personal thoughts of what?
Do we have another 1.5 hours?
No, but just in short, I think it's important we have international, you know, voices, that we have artists like you coming, and also, you know, supporting, you know, theater we were for. But
I'm very happy that we are bringing returning to Reims to St. Anne's Warehouse, because the show was made out of the impulse to do something immediately about this change. And just two things. I mean, I was thinking about yesterday, for example, I was thinking about, oh, there are so many resonances in the show with the situation, not only with misogynist Trump, but also with other misogynist people in this country. And Richard is also a master of misogyny in this show. And then there's a struggle for power. And there is this truth of aristocrats, which means my power I give to the next generation of my family, which we don't have anymore. And we have this idea of, or we do believe that we live in democracy. And then I was thinking about who creates or what creates a president nowadays. And of course, it's pretty frustrating to understand that you need a lot of people giving you money to make a campaign for being elected. So this can't be democratic, you know, because it means only if you have enough people with a lot of money, you can run for president, which is one thing. But also the role of medias, how to perform a politician. It's much more about the performance and not about the content anymore. So I would love to have politics where the performance is less important and the content becomes more important.
Yeah, I have to just build on that and say that one of the things that strikes me much more about Richard now than when I saw it in Berlin is the importance of Richard, the connection between Richard's Richard's totalitarianism and his self-theatricalization. He is the best, I think, self-theatricalizer in all of Shakespeare. And we're now very much conscious of the connection between that, what, as you say, this the showmanship of the modern dictator. I think that this is a great play to show that.
Well, thank you for, you know, all the outreach from the Schaubühne for coming here and your great work. So thank you.